Good morning, Jubilee. Sorry we're a little bit late. We had some technical difficulties, but we're all good to go. Who's excited? Brett's excited. I know Brett's excited. Let's stand.
Nothing has ever been the same again.
us a son is born, and unto us a son is given. On a bed, animals that fed, they humbled every king that ever lived. Let's sing that again. For unto us a son is born, and unto us a child is given. He's found a place so deep inside of me. When he was laid upon a bed, where all the animals that fed, and then he humbled every king that ever lived. And oh, what a beautiful day. Our beloved Christ is all the nation looking to him. And oh, we're living in these days when you came just like he said, and we are so glad you did. And oh, see that all you want is all of me. And I am learning to let go as you wrap around my soul on freedom's well-worn path around your throne. And I'm offering to your heart love inside your eyes. Can see that all you want is all of me. And I am learning to let go as you wrap around my soul on freedom's well-worn path around your throne. And oh, what a beautiful day. And our beloved Christ is all the nations looking to him. And oh, we're living in these days. And you came like you said, and we are so glad you did. And oh, what a beautiful day. Our beloved Christ is all the nations looking to him. And oh, we're living in these days. And you came just like you said, and we are so glad you did.
Nothing has ever been the same again. My Lord,
I look to the hills, from where does my help come from? I look to the heavens, from where does all my help come from? Oh. Thank you. my trust in you. I will put 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 my trust in you. As I gaze at the beauty of your face, everything seems okay. And as I dwell in the goodness of your grace, I know I won't be the same.
as I gaze at the beauty of your face, everything seems okay. And as I rest in the goodness of your grace, I know I won't be the same. Draw close to you, draw close to me, as I draw close to you, draw close to me, as I draw close to you. Draw close to you, draw close to you, draw close to you, draw close to you, draw close. Take all of me. So close, you were so close to me. You were so close, you were so close to me. You were so close. So close to me, my Father. You were so close. You were so close to me. I can feel your heartbeat.
So close to us right now. Father, we thank you that as we've drawn near to you this morning, that you've drawn near to us. Father, I thank you, God, that heaven is just a breath away today, this morning. Father, we thank you that heaven is so close, that your love is so close, God, that we're experiencing who you are. Father, you choose to say in your word that you are love. It's your very nature, it's your very character. Father, we thank you that we can become recipients of that nature today. We can be recipients of your love. Father, we can soak it up, that we can be filled, that we can be filled to overflowing with your love today. And we just receive that right now. Father, we receive that right now. And Father, we thank you that as we're receiving, God, that others get the overflow. Father, we thank you that as we're receiving your love, God, that our family members are receiving the overflow, Father, that our friends are receiving the overflow, God, that our work colleagues are receiving the overflow in Jesus' name. So, Father, we just prophesy right now and decree over them that as we draw near to you, God, that you draw close to them, that as we're drawing near to you today, God, that you're drawing near to our family, to our loved ones, to our work colleagues, God, that you're bringing transformation, not just in this place, but into the people that are connected to this place today in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you that it's not just about the four walls, Father, but it's about the connections, Father, to those that don't know you yet, God, to those who are hurting, to those who are lost, to those who have a lack of peace. And so, Father, we just thank you, Father, that as you're drawing near to us today, that you're drawing near to them in the name of Jesus. And everybody said, amen. That was a beautiful time. Give someone a hug on the way back and just say, God is so close to you today.
Check, check.
We have liftoff. Awesome. So welcome. Great to have you guys with us. Welcome to any first-time visitors. Great to have you here as well. And I don't know if we've organized this morning an offering team. So if four people that are fairly close to the bags don't mind jumping up quickly just to take up the offering today, that would be fantastic help. Thank you. So Izzy's back in the house. I mean, technically you didn't miss her because she was gone during the week, but we did miss her on Wednesday. So she's been visiting her mum, which is great that she could get that time. So it's great to have her back. But this week, Izzy's back doing Create School. So Wednesday, 5:30. Love, comfort, Holy Spirit. So you don't want to miss that. Wow, that sounded like intrigue, didn't it? Whoa, what could that be? And then Harp and Ball straight after at 7:30. And the young adults, if you want to join us this Friday night, it's Nightlife Street Ops. So they'll be out and about hitting, well, not necessarily hitting the streets, but certainly they'll be out and about. So please join us if you're 25-ish and under. They're cracking jokes up the front and I'm missing out on the fun. Passion and Fire. If you haven't yet registered, you have to get along to this conference. It's going to be amazing. We are so excited for Brian Simmons and his wife Candace being here. So jump online. The registrations are cheaper if you do it there rather than waiting and doing it online, doing it at the door. And come for the whole conference. Friday the 25th is actually a public holiday, well, for most people. So you should, some of you should be able to have the day off to come along to that as well. So it's Thursday night, all day Friday, and Saturday will be a full day, but not the night. So please jump online to find out about that. Baptisms next Sunday. So there's a few, I think there's about three or four that are getting baptized on Sunday. If you want to join those people, please come and see Finney or myself. And everyone is welcome to come along and just celebrate those people who are getting baptized. So it'll be between services down at Bronte Beach Pool. So come join us straight after the service. So it'll be roughly 1:30. So just leave straight from here. Fantastic. And also the Easter Parade. We were marching last year and we were probably the most vocal and the most active group of people. Obviously, besides Tommy Franklin, which we know and love well, who was dancing up a storm. But we want to try and match Tommy this year. So come and join us. Camo gear with your bandanas. And we're going to meet at Hyde Park at 10. So that's where the march is going to start from. So that's Monday the 21st, Easter Monday. Who's in? Awesome. Now, don't forget, straight after the service, if you signed up for the new members' lunch, so if you're new to Jubilee in the last 12 months, you signed up for the lunch, come through. And we always cater to those that may not have signed up yet. So anyone who didn't sign up for the lunch, but you are new to Jubilee, or you're just visiting, but you think, you know, this might be something that, you know, get to know Finn and Izzy and their heart and vision and meeting all of... So all the home, yes, free food, that's always good too. But also, yeah, just that you'll get to meet the home group leaders and some of the other leadership a part of Jubilee as well. So please come through, even if you didn't put your name down, but you're like, yep, I would really like to join to hear about, you know, the heart of Jubilee. Please, there'll be plenty of food. Nicola's next door cooking up a storm, Italian storm. So him and Max are in there, and it was like, lock the door. So it's all secret business in there now, so I'm not even allowed in the kitchen. So we're very excited about that. So don't forget, straight after, we'll head through, and we'll probably have lunch at about 1 o'clock. So you might just have to wait for about half an hour just to make sure that all the ministry time and stuff is finished in here as well. So testimonies. Simon.
Hi. Just quick, if anyone ever wanted to do what Jesus did, like how he just went around and healed people and spoke life and all this kind of stuff, come out on Friday night with us. It's like, I mean, it doesn't matter. Well, it does matter how old you are, kind of. But if you're talking spiritual age, it's kind of like we're all young adults. There you go. Hey, see? Got in there. But anyway... what we did for last Nightlife on Friday, Nightlife Equip, we got equipped by Bill Johnson, which was pretty epic. Went out to Dayspring and saw him, and he, at the end of his message, he goes, like, everyone who's got something wrong with them, put your hand up, blah, blah, blah. He, like, called out all these prophetic, these words. and then he was like, everyone's not got the hand up now. You guys are all going to go pray for these people. And I was, like, tired. I had a huge day. And I was like, I don't want to go and, like, start a conversation with someone that I have to ask what's wrong with them. So I saw this girl. I mean, I was feeling really, like, heaps of love flowing out of me. So I saw this girl with crutches. I was like, that's easy. I know what's wrong with her. She's got crutches. She's like, and a done up foot bandage, all this kind of stuff. I go up to her, I'm like, what's wrong with your foot? You've got a foot problem. See? See? And then she's like, I tore my Achilles tendon. And I'm like, oh, that's painful. And almost felt like going to someone else. But but then we started praying for her. And she was like more keen than we were and had more faith than I did. And there was no change at the start. And then we prayed again. There's a little bit of change. And then prayed again and again. Probably prayed about 8 times. And by the end of it, her Achilles tendon had reattached. And now she goes, takes off her bandage, chucks her crutches aside, starts jumping like this. I'm just like, that's pretty cool.
That's awesome. And the girls, the other girls, I think it was Michaela here? I think, yeah. She also laid hands on someone and they had cartilage returned to their knee. So
I'll have some of that. Friday I came in for an I-61. If you don't know what an I-61 is, do it! Really worth it. At the end of the I-61, Narelle wanted, she says, I've got to pray. And so I said, oh, my knees. Anyway, last Sunday, I couldn't sit in the seat. I had to sit on the ground. I'm going to get emotional. I had to sit on the ground because I couldn't actually sit in the seat. I can't generally move my knee. I can't get out of bed and put my foot to the ground. I have to put my toes to the ground at an angle down to put my foot down. Oh, good. I can't roll over in bed because I can't. I have to stretch my leg out, straighten it, lock it, and roll. It's the only way I can turn over in bed. Anyway, I didn't sort of run out of a Friday and run downstairs or anything. I just left and sort of said, well, God, show me what you've done. I walked down the stairs. I got home. I had to do a job for God after that. And I couldn't even drive to church last week, actually. I had to get out of the car and change with Paul. The pain was so bad. Anyway, so I'd driven in here, driven around, gone out to see someone and gone home. I was tired, but I got home. I have no pain or much decreased pain in my knee. There's sort of a numbness in there. But the change is huge. It was huge. When Narelle was praying for me, it's like, I don't know, it's like the Holy Spirit was just buzzing around in there. It was just the most amazing feeling. And so, yeah, God's amazing, and I'm believing for total restoration. I'll have some of the cartilage, yes. Well, all of it.
Just hands in the air if you need cartilage in knees. Yeah, we just decree right now, nothing missing, nothing broken. We just speak to every knee in this place that you would just restore cartilage. Restoration to every knee in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us know if you try something out. Let us know if that cartilage is back.
Hi, I was in a motorbike accident overseas, and a friend of mine sent out a prayer request to all you lovely people. And I just wanted to say thank you for your prayers, because I was in hospital on a drip every 8 hours. The infection wasn't leaving, and I felt your prayers when I was in Israel. And in a matter of, like, ever since I felt your prayers, it was like a day later and I was completely infection free. It's amazing. Yeah. And thank you. And the one that really spoke to me was little Joni and Sebastian. Like, laid hands on this, they saw my wounds and they laid hands on the screen, and it was when they were praying that I actually felt the breakthrough. It was coming from the children and from faithful people, and I just want to say thank you for being my family. Thank you for praying for my stupidity and for loving me just the way I am. I also want to thank you for praying for me to not have any plastic surgery. At the moment, I don't have to remove any parts of my body to cover up the bits. It's all grown back. It's healing. So thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus.
Hi. I've been praying to the Lord why I can't get the fullness of His love and everything. And I feel something to come on yesterday on the healing rooms. And I come in, and I was sitting in there, and the presence of the Lord was so strong. And the Lord brought something on my heart. And I did it. Straight away, I feel the word of the Lord say, you don't have to go to Darul to pray for you. And after that, what he say, everything was for my life. What I was asking to the Lord, everything, he just was answering it to me. That day was for me. And he restored me. He filled me up so much. Until last night, I was still feeling the presence of the Lord, making me free. And then I give the glory to him.
Yay, 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 yay. Okay, kids, have the best time in Kids Church. Thank you for the leaders going through as well. And we're going to hear from Fini this morning.
Let's give a shout to Jesus. Come on. Clear the sinuses and clear out any demons as well, any lingering religious spirits that they don't really like that kind of passion and enthusiasm. Oh, Ben and Jody here this morning. I've been looking out for you for them. They were going to visit from... No? Yes? Put up your hands. No? All right. They just said they might visit this morning. They're from Sunshine Coast, lead a church called Pour It Out. And It's a kind of Jubilee offspring. So, how many of you were here last Sunday night when we had a word from Charles Stock? Sunday night. All right, so I imagine that would be the case, probably half of you. So I want to just bring part of that word because it was a word for Jubilee. He said, look, he came on Friday, Saturday night, Sunday morning, Sunday evening. On Saturday night, he said, look, God's in the worship. God's given me a word for the church, that you're the church, you're the house of Obed-Edom. And I've read that account many times of the Ark of the Covenant being left in Obed-Edom's house. I never studied him. I've never looked into his life. And so on Sunday evening, Charles just delivered that word. And I think that's something, because we all want to walk together and walk in sync, walk in, together in this word. We don't want just half the church to be aware of it. But I would like you to encourage you to go on Ustream and watch that service. We did lose a little bit. There was a power outage somewhere towards the end. But he repeated the parts that were missed in part two of that. So it's all there. And I don't want to repeat everything because I can't. I'm Charles Stock. I'm Fini. And, but there is a there is something that we want to catch of the word of the Lord. When the Lord speaks to us as a church, it was a prophetic sermon. The whole message was a word for us. And so we want to embrace what God's saying. We don't want to just say, well, that was a great Sunday, a great weekend, a great time. Oh, if you're wondering what Tim's doing, if you're new to us, he's probably in a trance, and that's why he doesn't move. When you fall into a trance, you become less aware or almost not aware at all of what's happening around you, and you go wherever God's taking you. So he'll be very likely encountering God, doing some prophetic things, and we just are very relaxed about that. And and if you're like me, you just say, would it was me, Lord. You know, whatever he's having, I'll have that too. And you want to be... So I want you to turn with me to 2 Samuel 6. We'll read the account. We'll look into who this is, and we'll look into Obed-Edom. we'll read from verse 1. David again brought together out of Israel chosen men, 30,000 in all. He and all his men set out from Bala of Judah to bring up from there the Ark of God, which is called by the name of the Lord Almighty, who is enthroned between the cherubim that are on the Ark. They set the Ark of God in a new cart and brought it up from the house of Abinadab, which was on the hill. Now, where he got that idea from was that during the time of Saul, the Ark had been captured. They'd taken the Ark of the Covenant. How many know what the Ark of the Covenant is or was? We don't. It could still exist. We just wouldn't know where it is. And I don't think God would ever want us to know where the Ark of the Covenant was, because thousands or maybe tens of thousands or maybe hundreds of thousands would want to go there and find the Ark, you know, the lost Ark. Whereas, well, God said he would never again dwell in a building or an icon or a place built of human hands. He said that in the New Covenant. And we want to listen to God and say, well, then what is the spirit of the Ark of the Covenant? That's what we want to look at this morning. What's the spirit of the presence of God? Because that's what the Ark didn't signify, it was. God said, I will restrict myself to be manifest within a specific locality. And it was just a 1.2 meter box, not very high, not very big, carried on the shoulders of the priests. And Saul, in his own, he thought he could use the Ark as a good luck charm. And so he sent the Ark out to battle. Many times the Ark had gone out to battle. If you look at the history of the Ark of the Covenant, the Ark was present at the Battle of Jericho and was carried around the city 7 times. And the 7th time, when everyone was shouted, the walls of the city crumbled down. The city was defeated. So the Ark was present in many mighty victories. When they came to the Jordan River, the priests went forward first with the Ark. And as the feet of the priests touched the river stopped up. And then they waited in the river with the Ark. The whole river stopped up. The whole of Israel went through the river. And then they took 12 stones and built a memorial stone to remember that God stopped up the river Jordan to let the people of God go through and inhabit the promised land. The Ark followed them for 40 years in the wilderness as they went. And there was a literal pillar of fire by night and a pillar of cloud by day. So the Ark was a significant emblem, not just an emblem, a significant thing that God said, you must build this Ark. You must build this size and this dimension. And what was in the Ark? What was in the Ark? Apart from the presence of God. There were 3 things in the Ark. The New Testament tells us there was the tablets of stone, the 10 Commandments. There was the rod of Aaron, and there was the manna. So three important symbols of the presence of God. Number one is that it needs to be based around the Word of God. The presence of God is not separate from His Word. We don't become so presence-focused that we just don't know the Word. We need to know the Word, because the presence of God and the manifestations of God will never surpass or do things that we won't find in His Word. So we're very comfortable with angels, we're very comfortable with trances, we're very comfortable with manifestations of power and signs and wonders and mist and clouds of glory and extraordinary things. Why? Because it's in the Bible. If we see it in the Bible, old or new, the character of God didn't change when he sent Jesus. He didn't think, look, in the Old Testament I was a bit harsh, Father, and I've softened myself now, I've got a bit older. And I've got softened. You know, like when you see your children with your grandparents, and you're like, hey, you weren't like that with me. You become all smoochy and all soft and all nice and gentle and kind. And what's going on? Well, God's not like that. God's the same. He's not a grandfather. He's not old and got soft. No, He was always the same. And His character is found in His Word. And God does do strong things at times. God does have discipline. God does, but all of his discipline is through His love. And so the character of God is love. And even in the Ark was an Ark of love. It was the love of His manifestation. It was a manifestation of His love. And so in the Ark there was the Word of God. There was the promises of God. There were the conditions of God, of His obedience, of obeying God's commands. Amen. Number two, there was the rod of Aaron. Now, what was the rod of Aaron about? Well, if you look in Numbers 17 and 18, or 16 and 17 rather, you'll find that a whole lot of the leadership in Israel rose up against Moses and Aaron. And they said, why has God chosen you? Why should we listen to you? They were discontented. They were upset. They were having a whinge. They were having a go at the leadership. We know that has happened once or twice since then. And they were like, why should we follow you? We don't like you. We think that we also hear from God. And there was this murmuring that went on in the camp. And so God said, what I want you to do is I'll show you who I am on. I'm going to show you a sign. I want you to take a rod from every leader, every family head, and bring the rod and put it in the Ark of the Covenant. Put it there in front of the Ark. Put it in the presence of the Lord. They did that. They brought a rod from the 12 tribes. They brought every rod. And in the morning, they found the rod of Aaron had budded, blossomed, and had almonds on it. Come on. It hadn't just had a few little sprouts. There was actual nuts on this rod. That's nuts. That's fruitful. That's extraordinary signs and wonders. And what I gleaned from that is in the presence of God, there's no room for rebellion. In the presence of God, things are exposed. In the presence of God, the fear of the Lord falls. In the presence of God, we don't want to murmur against leaders and against movements and against things that have hurt us or disappointed us, because it grieves the heart of God. And that's part of the rod of Aaron, is that God will cause people and put his hand on people, and we must not judge them. And we must not think, why is their rod budding and why is not mine? I have no idea. But I know if I'm abiding in the vine, I'll be fruitful in the calling and in the place that God's called me to be fruitful. I don't need to compare my rod or my life or my calling to someone else. But I must honor everybody's rod. I got to honor everyone's rod. Come on. That's part of the parameter of God. That's why we don't discuss other churches. We don't criticize other churches or other movements or other leaders. We just move on with our lives. If there's hurt, we get healed. We forgive. We move on. That's the character in the kingdom of God. It's part of God's presence. And God said, you keep that in the ark because it must be a memorial to what I did. A few people died. The earth swallowed them. And if that wasn't enough, the following day the guys came back and they were still murmuring. And so a few more died. And then Aaron stood in the gap and it all came good. But Ananias and Sapphira died in the presence of God. Who killed them? Was it the devil? No. He doesn't have that much power. I'm not afraid of the devil. I'm afraid of God. Amen. When you're afraid of God, you're not afraid of the devil. When you're truly afraid of God, nothing else will make you afraid. The true fear of God is the beginning of wisdom. And it's the wise thing to fear God, to fear him in your speech, to fear him in your life, to fear him in your family. That's the wisdom of God. And that's what God was saying when he had these signs. The last sign was the sign of the manna, which was the provision of God. Is that God saying, there's a sign that I provided every day for my people for 40 years in the wilderness. I provided food when they needed meat, because vegetarianism wasn't sufficient, that I gave them meat. I gave them not just what they needed, but what they wanted. I imagine the manna was sufficient. There was sufficient nutrition in that vegetarian diet to suffice. Amen? But he gave them more. And God provided. Even their sandals didn't wear out for 40 years. Come on, that's good provision. Amen? And so those three signs were in the Ark of the Covenant. And the Ark of the Covenant was with Israel for all those years. It went out to battle. It came back. It split the Red Sea. Split the River Jordan. It split. It caused victories and battles. So God's presence with us, because we have become the Ark of the Covenant. We are covenant people in covenant with God, no longer going to a place, a holy place, a holy temple. We are temples of the Holy Spirit. We are walking arks of the covenant. When we go to work, when we go to college, when we go to school, when we visit our neighbor and have a cup of tea, we are the Ark of the Covenant in that place. And I'm saying this because the whole word from Charles was to increase our expectation for the manifest presence of God. That's all it is. It's an increased expectation of the manifest presence of God in your life and in my life. I want to fan into flame the Ark of God in you. I want to fan into flame the Holy Spirit who's living inside of you. I want to fan into flame who God has made you to be. I want you to be the happiest you can be. Amen? The presence of God is going to flow through your life. And with the presence of God comes all these promises which we're going to look at this morning.
I just want to encourage you that we are going to hear the message today. Because I really feel like God wants to do something in us, understanding what it is to honor the word of God. And like Finn was saying, the word is spirit. His word is spirit and it is life. And just because some of you are not feeling anything shifting or shaking, that word of God is alive in you. It's active. It's running through your cells. It's activating you. It's giving you vitality and energy and life and wisdom that you need for every single moment of your day and night. And whether you shake or don't is really not the issue. I want to encourage you. Some people feel the effects, but this word of God is available to everybody. And, you know, this week I was reading some doing readings with my family. And, you know, they don't shake, rattle, roll, nothing. And it was so beautiful to honor the word and to hear and listen, to go one reading after another, just to read it. And I feel like there's going to come again another wave of awakening again and a passion and a love for the written manner that we may eat and feast and stop this thing of it's the manifest presence is separate from his word. When Jesus opened his mouth and spoke, what he wrote here for us is manifest in us. It's life to us. We're not waiting for something separate or different. So I really feel like we kind of need to get this today and need to get it in, all right? We're not going to try and shift and change what's been organized. Thank you.
I like that, a manifest. We're going to have a manifest. So where did David get the idea of putting the ark on a cart? Because if he had read the word and the instructions in Leviticus are very clear about how to manage the ark. It wasn't like they never knew. It wasn't like, okay, we got this ark. How shall we transport it? Anyone got any ideas? No, David got the idea from the Philistines, because just if you look in the previous chapters, the ark was captured and they put it in the temple Dagon, and of course, as you know, the god Dagon just collapsed overnight on his face. They put him back up again. They thought maybe that was a coincidence. Hello, had that ever happened before? No, but they put it back up again the following day, just to make his point. God broke the head, took the arms off. It was useless. The god was completely decapitated by the presence of God. Come on. I know God's on the throne. He's bigger than any other God. He's the manifest presence of love and power and deliverance. He's the one true God. Every other God will bow down before our God. Every God will bow down. Every demon will bow down. Every issue, every opposition will bow down. Nothing can stand in the face of our God. He's the true God. Amen. Come on. He's the true God. There's no one like him. And so they were a bit freaked out, and they said, well, if this is really God, we will show this supernaturally by tethering some cows that had just given birth, just given calves. So they were full of milk, and they would never have naturally separated from their young because of all the oxytocin and all the hormones that they had. And so they tethered the cart to these cows who had just given birth, and put the ark on the cart, and the lowing, the Bible says, lowing as they went, off these cows went from the Philistine camp. They went off and just journeyed off. And so they knew immediately God has been doing something. Of course, there were tumors breaking out wherever the ark was. The ark wasn't good news for the people who didn't want it, or the people who just thought it was a good luck charm, or people who just thought it was something they could just add to their curriculum or add to their life. The ark actually caused chaos in some accounts. So David would have heard and known that the ark had been put on a cart. And so he thought, well, let's make a new cart because, you know, if it's new, God will love it. We've got a new idea. We read the book, you know, we've got the purpose-driven book and we've got the thing. We've got this new thing that we can learn. We can go to another church. We can find out how they do it and we can introduce it to our church, because if they're growing and we introduce it to our church, we can grow like they're growing, because that's a good idea. It's just copying. Or we can go to the world. We can get some good ideas, some management principles, and we can get some questionnaires and do some marketing, and we can just do all this stuff, because if we just have doing a lot of energy and stuff, and we get these good ideas, then surely God will turn up. That's what David was effectively doing. He was just taking ideas outside of the kingdom of heaven, outside of the Bible, and saying, let's just apply this to us and see if it works. That's what he was doing. Now, as it turns out, the drivers of the cart, one of them died, and that was a pretty sad event. And then David got cross, and then he read the Bible, and he realized that he was wrong. Come on. But in the interim period, when Uzzah died for touching the ark, to steady the ark, which was all in the Bible, don't touch the ark, don't look in it. Come on, that was just what God said. Read the Bible, then you'll be fine. The ark was always meant to be a blessing. It was never meant to kill people. It was never meant to cause tumors and hemorrhoids and mice. Amen. It was never designed for that. It was designed to bless, designed to be honored. If you honor the presence of God, all that can happen is blessing. Just don't mess with it. Don't trifle with the presence of God. Don't mock the presence of God. If it's the presence of God, if it's genuine, just honor it. Don't stand in the way of mockers. Don't be those who just observe and think, well, I don't know about that. Just shut up. Be humble in your observation of the presence of God. It's very important. So, so the ark was there, verse 4, and Ahio was walking in front of it. David and the whole house of Israel were celebrating and all with all their might before the Lord with songs and harps and lyres, tambourines, sistrums, and cymbals. When they came to the threshing floor of Nacon, Uzzah reached out and took hold of the ark of God because the oxen stumbled. The Lord's anger burnt against him because of his irreverent act. Therefore, God struck him down and he died there beside the ark of God. Then David was angry because the Lord's wrath had broken out against Uzzah, and to this day that place is called Perez Uzzah. David was afraid of the Lord that day and said, how can the ark of the Lord ever come to me? He was not willing to take the ark of the Lord to be with him in the city of David. Instead, he took it aside to the house of Obed-Edom, the Gittite. The ark of the Lord remained in the house of Obed-Edom, the Gittite, for 3 months. And I want you to read this with me in verse 11. And the Lord blessed him and his entire household. Say, and the Lord blessed him. And his entire household. So we see that the ark was the manifest presence of God. It was overlaid with gold. It had the cherubim above the mercy seat. There were these three emblems inside the ark. There was this amazing presence of God, but someone had died. There was doubt in David's mind as to how could they ever get this through, and so God helped him by blessing a Philistine and his whole household with more than they could cope with. So great was the blessing of Obed-Edom's house that it word got out that God had blessed Obed-Edom and his household. So I want to look at Obed-Edom this morning, that's the word, and show you a few things about him. Number one, and these are some of the points that Charles made, and I'll just add a few things of my own. Holy. Firstly, who is Obed-Edom? He's a Philistine. So here's the first word. God's presence comes by grace. His pedigree, it wasn't his qualification that caused God's presence to come to him. God kind of picked him out. He was in the right place at the right time, and God's presence manifested. How he received the presence determined what happened thereafter. He could have freaked out. He could have said, no way, Jose. His wife could have freaked out and said, you know, I've heard about what's happening, the tumors, the mice. I hate mice. I'm allergic to mice. Come on. She could have said, get that thing out of here. But the fear of the Lord came upon this Philistine household, and they honored the presence of God. They honored whatever. We don't know how they honored it, but they didn't resist it. They didn't resist God. They didn't resist his presence. And so everything around them blossomed. The grass was greener. The sky was bluer. Their flocks increased. Their wisdom increased. The children got smarter. There was just a blessing of God on his household that I want for my household. Because I want the presence of God to affect my household, because I am the church. You are the church. I don't want to think, well, Jubilee Church is blessed. Well, Jubilee Church being blessed is made up of 400 households. Maybe fewer than that. But 400 people that live in households. God wants to bless your household. He wants to bless your relationships. He wants to bless your family. He wants to bless what you put your hand to. He wants to bless your career. He wants to give you things beyond what you qualified to do. That's what this is about. He'll bless you beyond your qualifications. He'll bless you beyond what you think you should deserve. They hadn't put up their hand for the presence of God. They hadn't put up their hand for blessing. But God blessed them because he can. Because he wants to. And so are we going to say, yes, Lord? Just say, yes, Lord. I receive that, Lord. I receive the blessing of the house of Obed-Edom. You're just going to say that. Just put your receptors on. He began to experience the future and the power of the age to come. Here is Obed-Edom, and you can imagine him lying in bed at night and wondering why he's getting psalms, and why there's a mist over the house, and why he's hearing maybe angels singing, why his children are just blossoming, why neighbors just can't stay away from their house. They keep popping in, and they say, well, there's something about your house. There's something about your family. We don't know what it is, but have you changed something? Did you have a makeover? Have you done alterations? What is going on? Did you repaint the house? And they're saying, well, there is this box in the spare room. And ever since it came, everything's changed. Everything's changed. It wasn't that it was not noticeable. It was noticeable change. It was a noticeable manifestation. It says, when in the presence of the Lord, there is fullness of joy. It's noticeable. How many of you know that fullness of joy is noticeable? You can't really miss it. How many have been around people who haven't got the fullness of joy? It's noticeable. Isn't that right? You don't really want to hang around with them. But everyone wanted to be at Obed-Edom's house. Everyone wanted to share in the blessing, because when one person is blessed, you have enough to give. You have more. When you're not blessed, how can you give? When you not have an overflow, how can you give? So everyone wanted to be at Obed-Edom's house because he had come into a place of abundance and in a place of overflow. And that's what I want for you and me. So we want to say yes, Lord. Say yes to the word of Obed-Edom. Say yes to this prophecy. Say yes, Lord. We want our households to be place of overflow, place of abundance, places of blessings, place where things get fixed, place where things is more than enough. That's the blessing of the house of Obed-Edom. He was a forerunner, number four, experiencing the blessings of God's close presence and demonstrating the goodness of God by the blessing on him as an entire household. So this demonstration was the credible witness that David needed to know that it would be both safe and desirable to bring the ark into his capital city. What does that mean in everyday language? Because it sounds a bit, he constructed this sentence. It just means that if we as a church at Jubilee are able to manage and handle and treasure the manifest presence of God, it will make it safe for other pastors and leaders and churches to feel, these guys have done this for years and years and years. These guys have been in the trenches. They've understood the manifest presence of God. They're not trying to be smart. They're not trying to be clever. They're not trying to follow the latest fad. They just love God's presence more than anything else. It'll give other pastors and leaders hope. What he said was that the word Obed-Edom, he was a catalyst. A catalyst prepares for something else to happen. They cause a chain reaction for something else to happen. That's what a catalyst is. And God wants catalyst churches, catalyst places where the manifest presence of God is of prime importance, and it gives other leaders. It gave David hope. When he saw the blessing of the house of Obed-Edom, he thought, I can bring the ark of God to my city. I can bring the ark of God to Mount Zion. And it gave David courage. If it's happening for Obed-Edom, it can happen for me. So we as God blesses us, it won't be that we have to promote ourselves or say, watch our podcast. Guys, have you heard what's happening? No, God does that all by himself. You never have to promote the presence of God. You never have to shout and say, has anyone seen that? Have you not noticed how God is blessing us? No, it's just noticeable all by itself. God has a way of advertising his own presence. He has a way of promoting his own glory, and we want him to receive the glory. Because if the highest priority of Jubilee is the presence of God, then he will always receive the glory. Come on. He will always receive the glory. That goes without saying. The next point, though disqualified by natural descent, he was brought in among the Levitical musicians. This is the part that freaks me out, because the scripture is so clear about who should do what, especially in the Old Covenant. The Old Covenant was specific. If you were not part of the Levitical priesthood, then you couldn't do certain things. Only the high priest could go into Holy of Holies. Only the priests in a certain lineage could do certain things in the law, under the law. And yet, here we see in David's tabernacle, lots of rules being broken. Number one, he brings the ark and doesn't put it in Moses' tabernacle, which had been there for 300 or 400 years. Come on. 300 or 400 years, the ark was in one place. It was there. It was stable. It was settled. There was a ritual. There was a routine. There was certain procedures that had to take place. David takes this ark, the manifest presence of God. They realize, they read the book, they put it on the shoulders of the priests, they bring it back to Mount Zion, they erect a tent. So there was no Holy of Holies. There was no outer courts. There was no inner courts. There was no specific demarcations. For 40 years, there was a manifest presence of God in Israel that caused the fame and the influence of Israel to know no greater bounds other than in Solomon's time. Solomon took it further. But David increased the influence and the political and economic success of Israel beyond anything anyone had known up to that point. Why? Because of the manifest presence of God. Because of worship. He appointed 4,000 musicians who were on duty day and night. Come on, say 4,000. There's a big choir out there. They were on duty. They were part of the Levites. And I didn't realize this. I've studied the tabernacle of David for years and years and never picked up on the fact that Obed-Edom, the Philistine, come on, he made it into the worship team. You just work that out. It just goes against everything in Leviticus. It goes against the very rules that Moses made. Come on. They broke the rules. Obed-Edom and what Charles said was, it seems like he would have done that because he has a man who's been in the perfect light and glory of God for 3 months. He understood the presence. Let's bring him onto the worship team. So what's the qualification for the worship team? Presence of God. Do you understand the presence of God? Do you understand the manifest presence of God? And if you're a Philistine, you're welcome. There's grace. You see, the God announcing the gospel to Abraham in advance, God announcing the gospel through this amazing tabernacle, and here including Philistines on the worship team. Come on, just get the picture of grace. Get the picture of what God's doing. But not just Obed-Edom. His whole household, 62 of his relatives, or maybe those guys who came past and said, "Hey, I'm popping in for tea every day because I love your place. I love the atmosphere here. I love what God's doing in your life. I can see how God's blessed you. I just want to hang with you." God also included those guys, 8 sons who all became musicians and gatekeepers, and 62 family members who were also included amongst those 4,000 musicians that David appointed. Come on, that's a blessing. That's a generational blessing. So God is qualifying you this morning to say, "I'm qualified in the presence of God. I'm qualified by God's presence. What qualifies me is His presence. I'm not qualified because of my lineage. I'm not qualified because of my heritage. I'm not qualified because of my education or non-education. I'm qualified because of God's presence in my life." That's what qualifies me. Come on. All their generations were blessed. Everybody who came into their environment was blessed. Shabbat. Now King David was told, "The Lord has blessed the household of Obed-Edom and everything he has because of the Ark of God." So David went down and brought up the Ark of God from the house of Obed-Edom to the city of David with rejoicing. Shabbat. Thank you, Father. Whatever prophetic acts those are, Lord, we thank you for manifesting yourself this morning. Thank you, Father. So let's just open our hearts right now to His manifest presence. Father, we thank you for the Word of God, the prophetic Word of God that picks up a biblical story and makes it applicable in 2014. And Father, we thank you for the Ark. We thank you for history. We thank you for the victories in battles. We thank you for the healings that have taken place in history, even this week. And Father, we thank you, Lord, right now that we say yes to the house of Obed-Edom. We say yes to the blessing of how you blessed his household. And so, Father, just put your hand on your heart. Say, Father, we receive your blessing. We receive your manifest presence. We receive the fire of your kingdom. We receive the joy of the Lord, which is our strength. We receive the overflow of all that you have. We receive the fire of heaven. We receive the joy. We receive all that you are, Lord. All that you are releasing right now in Jesus' name. We receive it. We say yes, Lord. We say yes. We say yes to your word. We say yes to your influence. We say yes to the kingdom. We say yes to whatever you want to do here in this place and through us to the nations. Through us to the nations. We say yes, Lord. We say yes. Now just pray for the person next to you. Just touch their hand gently or their shoulder and just say, Father, bless this household. I want to pray blessing over this person's household and their family and their workplace and their children if they have children. We thank you for their careers. We thank you that you'll heal their bodies if they're sick. We thank you, Father, that you release life and light and hope and fire through them now. In Jesus' name. Shenda, satro, kose, brate, kese, kinda. Ho, barasiri. Ho, barasiri. Sandrin, gabrapan, song. Thank you, Father. 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 Just receive that now. If you're not comfortable with praying for other people, that's fine. You just relax. God's got you here, and you're going to receive the blessing as well, just because you're in the environment. We thank you, Father. There's always more than enough. There's always more than enough. There's always more than enough. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
I just saw a flash vision of, like, the breath of the Father that was just blowing dust off some of the promises that... There is a few people here that you've written things down from many, many years ago, from 15, even 20 years ago. And Jay, I think some of this is for you too. And I feel like he's blowing dust off that to say, awaken, that the word would be awakened in you. So we just want to respond to that. Holy Spirit, why don't you just come and breathe through these fatherly words that have come from Charles, from Finn. And we just thank you, God, that you are breathing life again, even on past promises and things that have been noted, things from Scripture that you have spoken to different family members that are going to be released at this time. And we thank you for the wind of your Spirit that would come and blow dust off, blow any sense of time or age or a sense of forgotten, the forgotten things that were written. And we just thank you, God, that your promises are yes and amen. That you are yesterday, today, and forever the same. That your wind would come to breathe life and spirit. Your words are life and spirit, and your breath is life and spirit to us. So we receive that, God, and we thank you. We thank you.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. I just want to bless the beaches. I just saw you guys sitting in the seats. They lead a church up in the Central Coast. Why don't you guys just come out and pray for you guys? And I'd love to bless pastors and leaders, because they are going to carry this, whatever they receive this morning, they're going to pass on to their congregation. Thank you, Father. Maybe some of the leadership team can just come and bless these guys. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. To stretch out your love and your hands to these leaders. Thank you, Father, for budding rods. Thank you for fiery life. Thank you for... Ooh.
inside out, from the inside out, everything shall sing again.
This morning, and just pray for the sick or any other needs that you might have. And so if the ministry team can just come out, and if the Lord's given you a word, just use the mic. And when they've given their words, and won't you sign your children out at 12:15, just so we honor the teachers and their capacity to look after our kids. And then we'll have lunch with the new members at 1. Thank you.
If you felt that that word was for you, that God is actually breathing life on things that have passed, come up as well. And just, even by faith, just stand. Just to receive an awakening from His Spirit. Thank you, God. Thank you. Yeah, I just want to release. Father, we just thank you for the wind of your Spirit to just come and awaken. Thank you that your Spirit is life, your words are life, and we thank you that you speak nothing without expecting a return. We thank you that you are literally welcoming the return of your own words of life. Thank you that you never plant something without looking for fruit. So we want to prophesy fruit from these words, fruit from these words, fruit from these words. We thank you that the buds will grow, that fruit will grow in Jesus' name. Thank you. Thank you, Holy Spirit.